Since the dawn of humanity, mankind has been obsessed with measuring things. The distance between cities, the length of a river, the size of mountains, and many other things. Climate change is no different, but how do we measure it? After all, climate is the long-term average of weather, so it operates over long timescales and large geographic areas. It's not exactly easy to quantify. But if we want to approach it scientifically, then measure it we must. So how do we do it? Well, it makes sense to start by measuring weather. Wind speed, air pressure, rainfall, and humidity are all measurable, and weather stations all over the world do just this. But ultimately, all changes in climate, whether it's rainfall patterns or humidity levels, are driven first by changes in air temperature. So it is temperature which climate scientists tend to focus on. And when it comes to measuring global climate change, we need to measure changes in global temperature. So how do we do this? We can't just jam a thermometer into the planet. That would be expensive, impractical, and ineffective, not unlike taking horse drugs to prevent COVID. And then there's the fact that the planet's temperature varies depending on where you are. The poles are colder than the tropics, the troposphere is warmer than the stratosphere, and the Earth's core is hotter than everything else combined, except maybe Jeff Goldblum. Anyway, scientists are normally most concerned with the air temperature at the planet's surface. After all, that's the bit where we live. But even so, the temperature of this part of the atmosphere can still be highly variable, even over small areas. The difference in temperature between a town and the surrounding countryside, for example, can be several degrees. This makes calculating the exact surface temperature of the whole planet exceptionally difficult. To do that, we would have to take the average of thermometer readings for almost every square mile of the entire planet's surface. And given that 70% of it is ocean, and significant areas of the remaining 30% are either uninhabited, inaccessible, or desolate, it is simply not possible to measure the exact temperature of the planet's surface with a high degree of accuracy. For reference, our best estimate is in the region of 15 degrees Celsius. But for the purposes of measuring climate change, when even slight changes of a few fractions of a degree matter, we would need a much more precise measurement than we can currently get. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. But Roche, what about all those graphs showing how global temperatures have risen over the last 100 years? If we can't measure the exact surface temperature of the planet, then what are they all about? Well, if you look closely, you'll see that these graphs aren't showing the actual temperature of the planet. They're showing temperature anomalies, which are defined as the difference between the temperature being measured and a reference baseline temperature. For example, if the average temperature of Gotham City was 15 degrees between the years 1900 and 1950, and this year it averaged 16 degrees, then the temperature anomaly would be +1 degree relative to the baseline period. Now, the main advantage of using anomalies rather than absolute temperature is that anomalies tend to be constant over large areas, even if the absolute temperatures within that area vary considerably. So if it's a degree warmer than normal in Gotham City, then the chances are it's a degree warmer than normal in the surrounding countryside, even if the absolute temperatures are quite different. This means that you don't need as many data points from around the world to build a global picture, though preferably your data wouldn't come from fictional cities. The other advantage of using anomalies is that we don't need to know the exact temperature of the planet in order to measure global temperature change. As long as the reference period is the same, we can take the average of anomalies from all over the world in order to calculate the global anomaly. And when we plot global anomalies through time, we can clearly observe a positive trend, which indicates that the planet is warming. The size of the anomaly also tells us how much warming has occurred compared to whatever arbitrary baseline we're using. This graph, for example, tells us that 2020 was, on average, a degree warmer than the 1951 to 1980 average. So that's why we use temperature anomalies rather than absolute temperature. But how do we go about collecting this data in the first place? Well, there are two key methods. The first involves collecting measurements from various weather stations around the planet, and these data are collectively known as the instrumental or surface thermometer record. The second, less accurate method, is via satellite. Now, unlike Jeff Goldblum, who is perfect in every way, both of these methods have limitations. A common criticism of the instrumental record, for example, is that the type of thermometer, the station location, or the environments around the stations can sometimes change, and these changes can artificially distort the data. This means that scientists must make adjustments to correct for them, something which climate contrarians love to claim is part of an insidious plot to usher in a new world order, or whatever it is they think is the end goal of their supposed climate conspiracy. Personally, I'm... what's the word? Skeptical. Anyway, despite accounting for these issues, there will always be a margin of error around the data, and this is why temperature graphs often have error bars on the trend line. This indicates that the actual temperature anomaly could fall anywhere within the highlighted area. Satellite data also has limitations. For one thing, it only goes back as far as the 80s. No! It also has to be adjusted for something called orbital drift, which can artificially introduce trends into the data. Additionally, satellites don't actually measure surface temperature. Instead, they measure the average temperature of the lowest 8 kilometers or 5 miles of the atmosphere, which is like pretty high. Again, this is where temperature anomalies become useful, because although the exact temperature of such a large chunk of the atmosphere will be quite different from the temperature measured down here, the temperature changes, the anomalies, should track the changes at the surface. And although both the surface and satellite records are imperfect, we can improve our confidence in them by comparing them to each other. And when we do that, they line up pretty well. Sure, it's not perfect, but it's pretty good. So those are the two methods we have for measuring temperature change on the planet, and they both pretty clearly indicate that the Earth is warming. But maybe you're still not convinced. Well, fortunately, there are several other indicators that we can use to infer global temperature trends, and again, by combining them together, we can increase our confidence in the conclusion that the planet is getting warmer. These are the amount of ice on the planet, the heat content of the oceans, and sea levels. In all cases, the trend is clear. The planet's glaciers, sea ice, and ice caps are all in decline, ocean temperatures are rapidly rising, and the rate of sea level rise is increasing. In short, it is absolutely unequivocal that the planet is getting warmer. Now, why it's warming, how this warming compares to the rest of Earth's history, and whether it's a coincidence that the hottest decades on record happen to have coincided with Jeff Goldblum's existence, are all topics for future videos. So if you want to see those, then make sure to subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified whenever I upload. Thanks for watching, and until next time, goodbye. Mankind has been obsessed with measuring things. That took a while.